Yeah. Brother Joe.
Amen.
You're a little off center if you want to move center.
Who did that?
I don't know what happened. I think they're saying you're a little lefty. A little left winger.
Shot guys.
How dare those guys.
Where's my boy Chance at?
So how's everybody doing?
Mm-hmm. Doing great.
I hope everybody had a good Thanksgiving and got to see their family.
Rested, slept.
I feel like I rested too much. I didn't do anything, but I came back tired somehow. So I'm kind of going to cheat a little bit today.
Ooh.
Me and Chris had talked. And we feel like that we've kind of been camping out on righteousness and haven't really progressed past that. And we've been wanting to really solidify the new identity in Christ. And so what I'm going to do today is kind of a Center of Hope knockoff and just kind of go over the book that we have all supposed to have been reading. But so today I'm going to read into this first chapter and just kind of go over it. If anybody has any questions, feel free to ask me, myself, Josh, and Chris. Would love to answer any of these questions that you might have, because this is very important. We can't progress without knowing who we are in Christ and knowing what He's done in us as new creations. Once you come to Christ and accept Him as your Lord and Savior, there are some things that you need to know. Otherwise, you wind up with, if you don't know who you are in Christ, then you don't have anything to battle with. And do not be deceived. This is a battle. This is a fight. It is a war. It goes over and over, and these words are used to describe this for a reason. This lifestyle is not easy. This is contradictory to the whole world and what everyone else is doing around us. For myself, I was raised in church, and I strayed away around 15, 16 years old and just decided to do my own thing, knowing better. I went as far as, to call myself an alcoholic for years and years and years, just in deception. And that's what I was. That was the identity that I took on, was an alcoholic. And then NA and AA and things of these nature is worldly institutions that do work for some people in recovery. They do work for some people, but our God says that we are a new creation in Christ Jesus, and that all things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so with that being said, as a new creation, this man that you see before you today has never drank a drop of alcohol. I don't have that in my system. Whenever I go into a store, which is every single store, I see alcohol. There is that choice. There is that option for me to indulge in the flesh. But this man that you see has never had that and does not need it. My spirit is stronger than the flesh, and I'm able to overcome through what the Lord has imparted to me through this book and His knowledge. It's not a part of this person that you see today, and that's part of being a new creation. There's no stumbling and falling and backsliding into addiction, because that is not a part of my DNA. It's not a genetic thing. It's not in me anymore. That is washed out with the blood of Jesus, and it is gone forever. Mm-hmm. But it is a choice. I have to choose to deny my flesh and walk past that section in the store and curse that section in the store. I don't play with it. I see it and I curse it. I put it down. some people say, well, okay, you can drink and be a Christian, and maybe for some people, but not this guy. That's up to each and every one of you, how you choose to walk your walk, but in my walk of faith, I choose to abstain from it. Not every now and then, not once in a while, period, I don't do it. So let me get into this here book here. And like I said, we're just kind of going over the same little bit. If you haven't read the book, please do. There's a reason why he has said it over and over and over, is to read it, and that's because there's knowledge in this book. These people that have studied their whole lives and been in the ministry for a very long time have put this together with the certain scriptures that are here and knowledge that the Lord has imparted to them for us to learn as newer Christians to learn from their walk as well. So just bear with me. And like I said, if you have any questions, ask, and we will try to answer them to the best of our knowledge. But I'm just going to start on page one and go through the couple deals. I timed this last night. It may be a little different today, but it took me about 10 minutes to do it. So, do you know where you stand with God? If you have ever made Jesus the Lord of your life, then you are separated from God by sin. Or if you have never made, excuse me, if you have never made Jesus the Lord of your life, then you have been separated from God by sin. You are the reason God sent Jesus to the cross. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten Son for you. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us. Jesus was the spotless Son of God. Sin was the reason he came to earth. He died on the cross and went to hell for one reason: to pay the price for sin. Once that price was paid, Jesus was raised from the dead, triumphant over Satan, and the sin problem was taken care of. God does not hold your sin against you. The only thing keeping you from becoming a child of God is failure to turn from your present world and your present God, Satan, and make Jesus the Lord over your life. And that there actually reminds me of Ephesians 2. If you want to turn or type and go there, I'm just going to cite it. Ephesians is by far my favorite book, and I probably teach or reference it every time I'm up here. Forever, because I've been camped out there and I have not left. Ephesians 2. Because it breaks down salvation and the way. Let's see, Ephesians 2. There we go. So, what that said. The only thing keeping you from becoming a child of God is failure to turn from your present world and your present God, Satan, and make Jesus the Lord of your life. So, Ephesians 2 puts it this way: "And he made you alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, Satan, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Among whom we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others." So before we come to Christ, our very nature is sin nature. We're born into sin because of what happened in the garden with Adam and Eve. We're not born with the nature of Christ, but whenever we become a child of God, and those things are washed from us, and we enter into his kingdom, we take on the nature of Christ. So that was Ephesians 2, 1 through 3. Back to the book. When Jesus paid the sin price for you, he became your substitute. Heaven is not recorded that you died on that. Wait, heaven has it recorded that you died on that cross over 2,000 years ago. You have been set free, but that doesn't mean you will automatically go to heaven. Even though God sent Jesus to pay for your sin, Even though he holds nothing against you, you can still go straight to hell. Why? Because you have not made the choice to receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, to accept his sacrifice as yours. You have free will, the right to choose your own destiny. God will not force you to receive salvation. The choice is yours. You can go straight to hell, and God will not lift a finger to stop you. He did all he is going to do whenever he sent Jesus into the world. The choice is set before you. If you do choose to make Jesus the Lord, your Lord, then God will receive you as his very own child. You will become a part of his family. He will be your father, and you will be his child. This is not a theological idea. It is a fact. It actually happens. Jesus actually walked the earth as a man, went to the cross, died there, and was raised from the dead and is alive today. He is seated at the right hand of God in heaven. When you become a Christian or born again, you take on his nature, the nature of God, your heavenly Father. The nature of sin and Satan is death, but the nature of God is life. Jesus spoke to the people of his day, saying, "Ye are of your father the devil," in John 8:44. When you accept Jesus as your Lord, you are turning from your back from the father devil, or the god of this world, as Satan is called in 2 Corinthians 4:4. You take on a new father, a heavenly father, and you are born again, not physically, but spiritually. Your spirit is reborn in the likeness of God. You see, you are a threefold being, and Chris has spoke on this multiple times. You are a spirit, you have a soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions, and you live in a body. Jesus referred to this in a conversation with Nicodemus in John 3:3-7. Jesus said to him, "You must be born again." Nicodemus replied, "What do you mean? Do I have to go back into my mother's womb?" Jesus answered, "No. What is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit." Being born again is a spiritual rebirth. You are born of the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit was sent into the earth to carry out this new birth. When you make Jesus the Lord of your life, the Holy Spirit comes to dwell in you and causes your own spirit to be recreated according to 2 Corinthians 5:17. When you accept Jesus as your Lord, you become a new creation, a new creature. Old things pass away, and behold, all things have come new. As far as God is concerned, at that moment you stand before him as a brand new person. You are reborn from sin and the death to righteousness and new life. Reborn from sin and death to righteousness and new life. 1 John 5:1-4 says, "Whoever believeth in Jesus Christ is born of God. And for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even in our faith." I want you to realize that what happens the moment you make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, in the eyes of God, you become a world overcomer. Sin no longer reigns over your life. It is no longer your Lord. Jesus is your Lord, and you can live above the satanic forces of the world. After Jesus was raised from the dead, he stood before his disciples and said, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Matthew 28:18. Then he delegated his power to his people, saying, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Mark 16:15. What is the gospel? The good news that God is no longer holding your sins and trespasses against you. The Bible gives some specific instructions that you are to follow to become a Christian or in order to be born again. And they look at Romans 8:10-11 here. The word is nigh thee. You know what? I'll look it up in the New King James.
Where's it at?
Romans 10:8-11. Because I know the nigh thee thou's kind of mess people up from time to time.
You want me to read it?
Yeah, go for it.
8-11?
Yes, sir.
"But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame.
So there again, it's all faith. Believing, confessing, and acknowledging, and the choice is also there. You can read the Bible all day long and have all this knowledge, but if you never choose to accept it and believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, these things don't happen. This new creation doesn't happen until you take these steps, really, in Romans 10:8-11, what he just read. Believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth, and making God the Lord of your life. If these things and these things haven't been done in your heart posture, in these steps, if you're just saying these things and doing a formula to produce some sort of outcome in your own life and have ulterior motives to get out of something or to get out of a tight spot, and you just want to make it through that day or whatever it may be, if your heart posture isn't crying out to the Lord in surrender, in true surrender, and you're not giving your life over and you're just saying, well, Lord, God, I'll do this if you do this for me. I don't believe that's how that works. Your heart posture has to truly change and be in the position to where you make him Lord over your life. And if you think about the word Lord, you know, back in the medieval times, they had lords over villages and towns, and that was a person of authority and of respect, and they also protected those people in that region and area. So the Lord of your life is someone who gives you these commands, and you are by his authority over you commanded and then obligated, or not obligated is the wrong word, then you are expected to do as he says. So as Jesus is Lord over our lives, it's no longer our lives. See, he paid the sin debt for us, so we owe our lives to live 100% for him as Lord over our life. So,
and I don't think obligated is the best word, right, but I think it's true, though. We are, I mean...
it's for lack of better words.
Yeah, but we love him because he first loved us.
Yes, and that's the nature of God. You know, it says that we take on the nature of God. And love is his. I mean, this is the biggest love story that you'll ever read. It's all about
from start to finish.
Yeah, Jesus says that you can hang all the commandments and all the sayings on love the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, body, and soul. And then next, right after that, is love your neighbor as yourself. So everything comes back to a root of love. He wouldn't have sent his son to die for us if it wasn't for the fact that he loves us. And these commands aren't something he just wants to, oh, you do this and you do that, and kind of what the world puts on as a face of religion. Oh, well, it's a list of do's and don'ts. No, it's he loves us, so he doesn't want us to put harmful chemicals in our bodies. He doesn't want us to go out there and kill our brother and steal things and just do wicked things. It's all out of love. And if you don't know what love is, this is the best way to find out, because I was so deceived in my past life on what love in the world meant. And I realized through study of scripture, I had no clue what it was until I got into this word and found out what the true love of God is. And, you know, it says that we can't even fathom it, you know, and I can't, I couldn't, and I know that I don't have kids here, like many of you do, but just think of sending your son or daughter to the cross. It's to even just be beaten, not even to die, just to say, all right, well, for Jeff, I'm going to get my daughter or son and just let them get the mess beat out of them for you, who owes me nothing, you know, but it's not of this world, that's for sure. Am I going too fast? Yeah.
I wanted to make a comment. And he does in the New Testament, I believe it's in Matthew, he says, and I leave with you a new commandment to love others as I have loved you.
Right.
So the second is talking about love yourself as you love your neighbors. So he shows up with a new command talking about, man, love everybody just like I have loved you. Mm-hmm. There's no greater honor than to lay your life down for your brother.
Your friend.
I mean, it's like gut check, Justin. What would you do that? And I'm like, that sometimes, thank you, God, for the basic instinct you've given me through my heart, a basic instinct that I know came from God because it did not come from me.
Right.
Like when something happens and there's precious children of God in crisis or I see something, all of my thought shuts down and it's like a basic instinct to go.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, sometimes I don't like it, sometimes I do. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I thank God for that. It's been difficult though.
Yeah.
But it's also been amazingly, supremely far greater high than anything I've ever experienced in this life.
Yeah.
To be able to be put in a position where somebody's in something and then get to see a smile afterwards. Yeah.
And you wonder sometimes, like I look back at my life and how I have sinned or even now when I fall short. And it says in the word, judge not, lest you be judged. Like, is that like a supernatural occurrence in our lives, how God restores us so quickly because how we've loved or how we've, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you're a very judgmental person, and then all of a sudden you fall short and you sin, you might get tore up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because judge not, lest you be judged. Because you have a kind heart, you've always loved and been obedient. When you fall, then God will. It's just like
God's grace
restored so quickly.
Yeah.
So that's
yes,
a good
sir.
Word. That's a good.
Yeah, I just want to say, you know, in the world, 2 + 2 = 4, right? In heaven, dealing with God, 2 + 2 could equal 4.5, 5.8. That's the God I serve. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, whoa, how do you do that?
Right.
Yeah, how do you? He's definitely a God of multiplication.
And you know, kind of going off what you said as far as. You know, you have this reaction of a love that's unnatural and it comes out of nowhere all of a sudden, but you have this, you feel this draw to do something for someone that you normally wouldn't, and you said it yourself that, you know, sometimes you don't really want to do it. That's the flesh coming in to war against the spirit. You know, you have this, the Holy Spirit says, well, you know, do this for someone. And then right immediately in my own experience, the devil in your own flesh and your own mind is just like, oh, well, you don't need to do that. You don't have to do that. You know, it's just that's not going to pay off. It doesn't really matter. You can just keep going about your day and they'll never know you were here and you'll never know they were there, blah, 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 blah. But that's not the case. The Spirit led you to do those things. And, of course, the flesh and the enemy is going to try and stop you from stepping into God's will for your life. You know, and so once you combat that and you say, you know, I'm going to do what I feel the Spirit is leading me to do, and you step into, you know, that calling that you have for that moment and that day to step into whatever it may be, it opens up the floodgates of heaven whenever you walk in the good works that the Lord puts before us, you know, and it's, You could say, yeah, of course. Well, that person doesn't know I'm here, and then you just go on about your day, and you ignore that, and you go about your day pretty much fine. But once you step into it, and step out of flesh, and go into the Spirit where He's drawing you to be, there's no better place to be.
Dude, I don't want to be facing the Father all alone with nobody else around me. Josh, nobody's going to be standing by my side. When the Almighty looks down on me and says, give me an account for what you've done. Remember that day you did this?
Right.
Remember that day I placed you in front of that old lady who couldn't carry her groceries and she fell and you walked away? I need to know what you were thinking when that happened. When I drove you through the Spirit to pick her up, pick her groceries up, when walking home. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I mean, it's accounted in
scripture. I don't even think you're going to bring any of that up, though.
I don't think so, no. The beam of seed, I don't think he's going to.
We were talking the other day, me and Justin, he was like, you know, we're still going to be accounted for the things we did wrong. We're still going to heaven. But we might just have to cut grass for a couple years.
I don't think so. No.
That's what I said.
No. The bema seat, when you're in heaven, judgment passed. The white throne judgment, though, I think your sin will be brought up there, but the bema seat of Christ, I mean,
you're already in heaven.
It's paid. It's done. He's not going to bring it up. He's not. People say it holds you accountable. It says
to your good works, right?
Mm-hmm. So I think he's going to be talking about the good things that you did. No, you did this. You're obedient. You did these things. And that's where you'll receive rewards and crowns. But once you get to heaven, there's not going to be any more judgment or guilt. It's done. It's passed. He blotted it out. It's done. If you sin, it's blotted out. He doesn't even remember it. He's not going to ever bring it up to you. That would be so contradictory
to
the word. Yeah, I just don't. Yeah.
You are forgiven.
We're going to be cutting grass for a couple years.
Yeah. With a sling blade.
Yeah. With one of them blade. Push mowers with the.
Yeah, the blade.
But we're going to make it to heaven. We'll make
no,
it.
No, we'll no. I don't even think, as far as like, we're not going to be up there, there's not going to be any status. You're not going to get like a bigger, you're not going to live on like a higher floor of the New Jerusalem because you were, you know, kin of pagan. Because all your crowns are going to be cast at the feet of Jesus.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's going to be something that people are going to see like, oh, look at all these crowns Joe has and cast at Jesus.
Right.
And you're thinking, man, he must have, no.
Nobody would even see it. You just, for you.
Yeah. It's all going to be about Christ. It's
right.
Not going to be about what you did or what you accomplished. Because really, honestly, we didn't accomplish jack.
Yeah.
We didn't do jack.
Yeah,
he did it all.
Right.
He paid it all.
Reminds
yeah.
me of that.
You applied the blood, you used your life, and you had it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Starting.
I mean, it
that
says
that.
In Galatians 3 it's by the Spirit and by Christ and our faith in Christ, believing in Christ, that's the only way that we receive any of the blessings. We receive salvation, it's all through faith. It's not by works. It's not by following the law of Moses or in the covenants of Abraham. It's by just all that is gone. The new covenant is by faith. We believe that Jesus died for us, and that's it.
That's right. Fruit comes from abiding.
Yeah. Right.
Fruit. The fruit of good works
right.
is a product of
right.
abiding in the vine.
That's
it's not, and if it ever gets into that point where it's a work that you're, it's
right.
pointless, it's worthless.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's religious.
It's a work that what?
If it ever gets to a point in time where it's something that you're producing, that you're working, you're like, oh, I have to do this because Jesus, you know,
yeah.
if it's ever, it's you know,
yeah.
fruit. Like if you said, if the tree's good, if the roots are good, the tree will be good, the fruit will be good.
Something always like the giant said, he said, fruit don't lie. Like if you're producing good fruit,
that's right.
Then it's coming from
you're abiding.
Yeah. Exactly.
You're right. Getting pruned. You're getting, you know.
A pear tree can't bear apples.
That's right.
A good tree is going to bear good fruit.
I heard one of the most profound statements. I mean, a little over a year ago when I was at your house, brother, and we were talking about the fruits of the Spirit, and I guess this is when thinking above board. This is the 4.8 type stuff. When Chris said, I want to have a tree of the fruit of the Spirit so vast that others will come and take shade, be
yeah.
able to take
yeah.
shade on
yeah.
my tree.
Yeah, low-hanging fruit. Yeah.
That was, I was like, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So, just to be able to do that and have folks come up to you, they're downtrodden, waiting for the adoption, aggravated, waiting for the adoption of son to sonship.
Yeah.
And they just said, man, look at that. I need to go
yeah, I won't
get
yeah.
with this person and just stand next to him for a minute, and I know my heart will start to smile. Just if I'm standing next to him.
Amen. Me and Justin stumbled across in some commentary the other day where it said that true fruit, bearing true fruit, that fruit that you bear has the ability to bear more fruit from it. So whenever you look at a fruit, there's a seed within it. So if you look at it and you say, okay, well, this fruit, it's just a fruit. No, it has a seed in it, so therefore it can be a tree that will produce more fruit. And really, if you look even further past that, if you look at the fruit, there's really a forest or a whole plantation full of potential there. There's so much potential, and see, we're created in God's image, and He's omnipotent, omnipotential. He's all potential.
Yeah.
So everything that He is, we are, and everything around us, He is and is in. So we have the potential, all of that within us. And there's this book, Understanding Your Potential, that we went through in the Center of Hope, and it's fire. Because, I mean, just knowing that you're created in the image of God and who He is, everything, and everything was within Him. Because before there was nothing, there was God, so there was only potential. And then He spoke, and here all this is. And we have that within ourselves, that potential to become what He wants us to be, which is just the best thing. Like what any father looks at their son and says, well, I want him to just, you know, work 9 to 5 and or be, you know, just whatever. I just want him to be subpar. Nobody says that about that. They want him to be the greatest. They believe that he can be the president. That little guy right there can be the president. And, you know, or whatever. And I don't know, I'm not going to get into president. You know, what father wants to give his son a snake instead of a fish. You know, he just wants everything the best for us. And he gives us this book, and he just begs and pleads us to obey it and live and walk in his light and as he's commanded us to walk. And the Holy Spirit comes alongside us, and at the point of being born again, we have the Holy Spirit inside of us and to help us, and we have to have it, and we need him every single day. But I hope this helped somebody.
Yeah. Amen.
Good morning, John.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.